الله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. الله جعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. وأوصيكم نفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، وقد أمرنا بالحق، وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. ثم أما بعد، we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bearing witness that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for Him subhanahu. And we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, His family, His companions, and those that follow until the Day of Judgment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst them. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كِحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. That verily from amongst those who took partners besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their shirk, or their way of associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was not that they worshipped something besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they loved something as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be loved. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And those who believe love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than anyone else can love anything else. And this is an extremely powerful ayah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us two things in this Qur'an. Number one, in this ayah Allah azza wa jalla says that there is a sense of shirk that is shirkul mahabba, which is the shirk of loving something the way you should love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number two, that no matter how much you love something besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has experienced the joy of loving and being loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be outdone. The one who has experienced the joy of his salah, of his prayer, the one who has experienced the joy of talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua, the one who has experienced the joy of living a life of purpose, and that only purpose is to fulfill what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made blessed, and to leave what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded him to leave off. Whoever tastes that blessing of having a true meaningful relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a relationship like no other relationship in this world. And let's face it, you know, it's one thing to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to do. It's another thing to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a difference between obligation and punishment and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'll give you this example. Some people come to Salat al-Jum'ah to get Jum'ah out of the way. Just come to the khutbah, get it out of the way so I can say I got my Jum'ah out of the way. Throughout the time, I'll just hear a nice little bedtime story and take my lunch nap, my qaylula at Jum'ah. I'll just take a nap. But I got Jum'ah out of the way. Alhamdulillah, I fulfilled Jum'ah. You know, I'll show up at the end, block people's cars if I have to, you know, hang out in the back, and then I'll pray. And alhamdulillah, I got my Jum'ah out of the way. Whereas some people come to Jum'ah with a sense of purpose, understanding that Allah has given you an opportunity to be forgiven for the past week. Come to Jum'ah with a heart that is missing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ready to absorb what the khatib is saying, whether he's a boring speaker or not, ready to hear the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to act in accordance with it. Some people pray five times a day, some people do their salah, but Allah azza wa jalla tells us even the hypocrites used to pray. But what's the thing about the hypocrites? إِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَ. When they get up for their prayer, they get up lazy, angry. You know, كُسَالَ, كَسَد, doesn't just mean laziness, it means agitated. Like, man, I gotta do another prayer. We just prayed Dhuhr. With this new time change, the salawat are too close by. Now when they hear a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they can't find a loophole, then they'll do that command, but they'll do it with mediocrity. There's no real love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the purpose of those good deeds, which is to bring the servant close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not being realized.
So Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us something about loving Him.
And I want you to listen very closely to this hadith. It's a very beautiful hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith Qudsi from Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhum, Sahih al-Bukhari, مَنْ عَادَ لِي وَلِيَّ فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Whoever takes one of my awliya, one of my beloved, as an enemy or shows hostility towards him, فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. I will wage war against him. Think about that. Now, usually, whenever a person is lower in status in a relationship, they are the ones who boast about that relationship, right? A person who's not that attractive marries someone who's very attractive, they'll boast about having the relationship with the attractive one. A person of low status has a relationship with one of a high status, they'll boast about having that relationship with the one with high status. Right? A person who's poor will boast about having the relationship or having a connection with one who is rich. Rarely do you see that the one who is higher boasts about the relationship with the one that is lower. And there is no greater discrepancy and no greater distance in status and in anything than there is between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, and the khalq, and just us, creation. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us from nothing. Allah owes us absolutely nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have just told us, look, do this or you go to hell and that's it. It's His right, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is proud of His relationship with one of His beloved. Even though the one that He loves is much lower than Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no greater distance, and no distance can describe how different Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from His creation. But you know what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us? When Allah loves a person, it's an actual event. It's an event to Allah. Something happens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا. If Allah loves someone, نَادَى جِبْرِيلَ. Allah calls Jibreel alayhi salam. And He says, Ya Jibreel, إِنِّي أُحِبُّ فُلَانَ. I love that person. So you should love him too. So Jibreel alayhi salam loves him too. And Jibreel alayhi salam calls Ahl al-Sama, all of the inhabitants of the heavens, and says, Inna Allah yuhibbu fulan. Allah loves this person, you should love him too. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then allows that love for that person to be transferred to the hearts of the people of the earth. Yudla'u lahu al-qabulu fil ardh. Acceptance and love is granted in the people's hearts for that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treats it like an event when Allah loves a person. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that relationship is very special. It's very sacred. It's not about, you know, whether he's going to do as much as I did for him. It's not about that, because that's impossible. It's that this person is going out of his way to please me, although he doesn't see me. Now I want you to think about that. The love that a person has for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what effect does it have on the one who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? For one thing, it's no longer a relationship of just obligation and prohibition, of reward and punishment. It goes much further than that. And Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he said that there was a righteous king who used to say that he loved his general more than he loved his kids. And his kids told him, why do you love your general more than you love us? You know, this is just a guy that works for you. Why do you love him more than you love us? We do everything for you. You know, we take out the trash, whatever it is. We bring you food. We do everything we're supposed to do. You tell us to do something, we do it. You know, we're respectful. We're good children. And he said, come with me. And he took him out on an expedition. And Imam al-Qayyim rahimahullah said that the king stopped. And he looked like this. He looked forward. And he looked at a well of water. And the general ran to that well of water to bring him a glass of water. And he said to his kids, that's why I love him more. Because I would have to tell you to do that. Subhanallah. He had such a relationship with him that he just knew that is what would please him. He didn't have to be told, go get me water. Go fetch me the water. He just saw that the king's eyes fell upon that well. And he immediately went and got that glass of water. That it's a much hot, love does things that subhanAllah, you know, the obligation prohibition cannot do. As Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings out of the servants even what Kitabullah, the Qur'an, does not. It makes him do things that even the Qur'an does not, because he starts seeing things and he tries always to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he sees everything as an opportunity to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because Allah means everything to him. It's an event. It's an event in his life. It's something, it's serious to him, right? It's something that's so sacred to him that he would do anything for the object of his love, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that's a sign of love. It's very easy to say, I love you. But you know what? A true expression of love is, I would take a bullet for you, right? I'd do anything for you. That's why the Sahaba, when they said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that, you know, that we love you more than we love ourselves. And you, if you remember when the delegation from Quraysh came and they saw the way the Sahaba treated the Prophet ﷺ, said, no way. You know, we've seen Caesar, we've seen Kisra, we've seen all of these rulers. No one is more loved by his people than Rasulullah ﷺ. Even though he doesn't give them, you know, high salaries, the Prophet ﷺ doesn't have them, you know, sitting in palaces. The Prophet ﷺ has them struggling, has them risking their lives, spending all of their money for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say to the Prophet ﷺ, that you are more beloved to us than our own selves. It shows in Uhud. It shows whenever the Prophet ﷺ is attacked, and these Sahaba throw themselves on the Prophet ﷺ. Abu Dujana radiallahu ta'ala anhu is back becoming littered with arrows. Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu trying to catch the arrows as they're coming at the Prophet ﷺ. That's something that cannot just come out of obligation and prohibition. It's something far greater than that. It's love, it's hope. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us in the Qur'an, a person who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far more willing to do things for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has a much stronger relationship and connection than any other person, any other human being. And I want us to just transfer this to our own lives for a moment. When you love someone in this world, you love them for some quality. You love them for something about them, right? Some qualities that they have. As soon as those qualities are absent, the love disappears. And that's why marriages fall apart that are built on superficiality, right? You married someone because they were attractive, and then guess what? They weren't so attractive to you anymore. The love disappeared because you didn't love the person, you loved the quality, right? Whereas if you love the person's insides, if you love the person's khuluq, if you love their character, then the character is going to stay the same. Right? The character will still be there, that inner beauty will still be there. But usually when you love someone, you love them for something. And when that disappears, you no longer love that person. The object of your love changes. Now with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I want you to think about this. With a human being, when you truly love them, if that person told you, I'm not happy with what you're doing, but I'm going to let you do it anyway. I really hate what you're doing. I dislike it, but I'm going to let you do it anyway. If you really love that person, would you still go out and do that? No. But whenever we hear that something is makruh, right? It's just disliked. It's not haram. You know, I heard a scholar say it's just makruh. You know, don't worry about it. A scholar said it's makruh. You know, don't worry about it. You're literally saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, I know you hate this, but I don't care. It's not haram. You didn't tell me not to do it. You didn't command me not to do it. Right? Or when someone that you love tells you, that you know what, I'm not saying you have to do this, but I'd be very pleased if you did do it. I'd really appreciate it if you did it. If you really love that person, have you ever seen what a person looks like when they first get engaged? Right? She says jump, he says how high? Right? That's the same. Well, if you really love a person, you know, you're not going to wait for the person to say, look, you have to do this or else. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, show us something that is mustahab, sunnah, mandul. It's recommended. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to punish you if you don't do it. But it's recommended. Will you do it or will you say, alhamdulillah, it's just sunnah. It's just the sunnah. Do you really think the Sahaba would have ever said, it's just sunnah? You know, those are the types of things we say now. It's just sunnah. You never say that. Because you're seeking Allah's love. You're seeking something higher than that. Or if someone, you know, if you came across something that may or may not break your relationship, sever your ties with the one that you love, and you can't get a clear-cut answer, you don't know, you're in a situation, She might hate this or she might not. It's, you know, 50-50. Would you take that risk of severing that relationship with that person? No. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Messenger of Allah left something in the gray area, it's a shubha. Some say it's halal, some say it's haram. It's a doubtful matter. And you still engage in those same shubhat. You still engage in those same doubtful matters. Well, hey, look, it's not haram for sure. No one has really said it's haram for sure. That's not the way that a person who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala acts. In fact, that's not the way that a person who loves another human being acts. When you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what happens to you? And you know what the problem is? Is that we read in the lives of the Sahaba, we read in the lives of the Salaf, and it's like, okay, to really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I need to be robbing someone's house, and then أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَخْشَعْ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ needs to be revealed. Right, some ayah needs to come down upon me. Or I need to be riding in a car and my car needs to flip 20 times and then I need to hear a bird reciting the Quran and then you know what? That's how this person became religious. That's when I'm really going to fall in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? You're waiting for some miracle to happen. Some extraordinary thing to happen. And you know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith? That whenever the servant loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُ عَلَيْهِ. My servant doesn't come close to me with anything more beloved to me than the things, than the obligations. We realize the goal through the means. Praying five times a day, fasting in Ramadan, right, giving our zakat. We're realizing the goal. You're getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know what happens? You've tasted the sweetness of your prayer. وَمَا يَزَالَ تَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ. You've tasted the sweetness of your prayer. Now you want to pray sunnah. You're not just getting up because you have to. You want to pray more. You've tasted the sweetness of fasting. You want to fast, you know, Mondays and Thursdays, or find some other days to fast. You've tasted the sweetness of giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in zakat. Now you want to give sadaqah. You went to hajj, and you know when you come back from hajj, some people say, Alhamdulillah, I finished hajj, I am never coming back. I'm done. That means your hajj probably wasn't an accepted hajj. But if a person finishes hajj and says, as tired as they are, as beat up as they are, say, I can't wait to come back to Umrah. Hajj or something. I need to see the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again. I can't wait to be back in Islam. Tasted the sweetness of it. So you start getting close, you start developing with a nawafil. Then Allah says, Hatta, until I love him. Until I love him. That's when Allah really loves you. When you're making that kind of effort, you know, when you start tasting the sweetness of things, and you know what? You do things because you want to do them, you feel motivated towards them. You're realizing that in your salat, you're taking your time with your prayer. Right? You know how much khushu' we could develop if we just took time in our prayer? Right? Just took time to focus on what we're saying, focus on what we're doing, focus on the moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that effort from you. And then you know what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot wait to meet you. Allah azza wa jalla is excited about meeting you. As he says to Rasulullah, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith Qudsi, that Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ لِقَائِي فَأَحْبَبْتُ لِقَائِي. Whoever loves to meet me, I love to meet him. I can't wait. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to meet you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking forward to that standing in front of him. And we also want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said, when you fear any creature, you run away from it. But when you fear Allah, you run to him. Right? It's the opposite effect. Why? وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Although I know I've got a lot to worry about, I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I can't wait to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can't wait to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can't wait for that momentous occasion. Why? Because it's not just about this, that. It's not just about obligation and prohibition. Although you cannot realize that love until you're fulfilling the obligations and avoiding the prohibitions. So there's no way to attain that love otherwise. But it's so much more than that. It's a willingness to adjust your lifestyle. It's a willingness to do things because they're pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not because you have to. It's a willingness to lose some friends sometimes. It's a willingness to be looked at as a strange human being. Ghareeb. It's a willingness to be socially awkward. Why? Because I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Ibn Qudamah rahimahullah said, that the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only thing that will protect a person from being corrupted with his good deeds and corrupted from his evil deeds. Right? You're not going to fall into haram and things of that sort knowingly. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that. وَلَمْ يُسِرُّوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ They don't commit sins against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't do what displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knowingly. You're not going to do that if you're loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you have a personal relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? But you know what you're telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you sin and you know that you're about to commit a sin and you don't stop yourself anyway and you just go forth with it? You're saying, oh Allah, I know you don't like this. I know that this angers you and I know that you told me not to do this, but I'm going to do it anyway. That's why sin is so detrimental to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then on the other hand, your righteous deeds. How does the love of Allah protect you from your good deeds? Because what if you're doing your good deeds, but you're doing it to show off? What if your good deeds are for riya? Or what if they're developing pride, they're causing you to develop kibir, pride? What if they're causing you to develop urj, you know, be fascinated with yourself? Then it's all worthless. But if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I don't care if this person thinks that I'm good. I care if Allah thinks I'm good. I don't think I'm better than this person because I know Allah, how much better Allah is than me. There's no comparison between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It protects you from your good deeds and it protects you from your bad deeds. Because it's personal. It's more. And I'm going to leave you with one thought as I sit down. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says to Ubay, read to me because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that you recite to me. Read the Qur'an to me. Recite. Allah has commanded me that you recite. And Ubay didn't think to himself, oh, Rasulullah is asking me to read to him. Wow. He didn't think to himself, you know, wait till I tell the Sahaba that, you know, I was with Rasulullah the other day and he said Allah told him that I should read to him. He didn't think of that. You know what he thought of? You know what he says to the Messenger? He said, did Allah say my name? Did Allah really say my name? Allah thinking of me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning me? Allah really said my name? That's a person who loves Allah and who has something personal, a secret between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or her and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something that is so personal that not even their family members know about it. A secret charity perhaps, a secret prayer, secret dua, something between that person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody knows. Whereas some people have the secret sins, secret disobediences, that they're ashamed from the sight of the people, but they're not ashamed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Develop that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no excuse for any one of us not to talk to Allah. Because you know what? The language of love is not Arabic. You don't have to speak Arabic to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to. You can speak to Allah any way that you want. There is no prerequisites to speaking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make your relationship personal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment, it's a reunion, it's happiness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to love us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who love and hate for Him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring us close to every good deed, every deed that brings about His love in our lives. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimin. Fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين ولا عاقبة للمتقين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, in conclusion, and I want you to think very deeply about this. Where do you stand with Allah? If you were all alone in the middle of nowhere, where is your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When's the last time you spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone? When is the last time you did something for Allah alone? When is the last time you sat there and you imagined the day that you would stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When is the last time that you thought to yourself, I have to meet Allah whether I like it or not? And as Imam Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, some people will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it would be like long lost relatives, right? It would be like a family reunion coming together, and some people will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like slaves who have escaped from their master, and they're brought back on that day. How will you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, He says very beautifully. He says, السعيد في الدنيا من ترك الدنيا قبل أن تتركه الدنيا. The one who truly gains happiness in this life is the one who abandons the world before the world abandons him. السعيد في الدنيا من بنى قبره قبل أن يسكن. The one who is happy in this world, the one who truly has happiness and joy in this life, is the one who builds his grave before he even resides inside of it. والسعيد في الدنيا من أرضى خالقه قبل أن يلقاه. And the one who truly has happiness in this world is the one who pleases his Lord before he meets him. Pleases, sets the stage for that meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's 50,000 years of standing, dear brothers and sisters, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Tirmidhi, that for the believer, hadith sahih, for the believer, the day of judgment will be like the time between Dhuhr and Asr. Piece of cake. You're meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is going to make that a momentous occasion. But talk to Allah. Allah wants you to talk to Him. Allah wants you to do things for Him. Do things for Him because you love Him. Do things for Him because you can't wait to see Him. And even if you can't put together a fancy dua, even if you can't read Arabic, even if you can't, you know, do tahajjud all night, and all you can do is just make a little bit of dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and some tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just seeking His forgiveness, that's enough. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah is more happy, more pleased with the tawbah, with the repentance of His servants, than a man who lost his camel in the desert. And that camel was his means of living. And he was stranded. And then he finds his camel. And he calls on to Allah. And what does he say to Allah? Ya Rabb, oh my Lord, you are my slave. Anta abdi wa ana rabbuk. You are my slave and I am your Lord. Not because he meant it. But it was a moment of love, intense love, and he mixed up the words. And Allah is happy with that. Allah is pleased with that. Because it was a true expression of love. Call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your moments alone. And have something, a secret between you and Him, that you'd like to come out only on the Day of Judgment, that no one else knows about. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst His true awliya, those who are truly beloved to Him, and those who truly love Him. Allahumma qabbal al-mu'mineena wal-mu'minat wal-muslimina wal-muslimat.